Good morning, everybody. Welcome to this morning's worship service. Now, I need to say I'm blessed because I'm up here and I can actually see people that I haven't seen for a while, and I can even see your faces, which is awesome. I know we've got some visitors here today, so I'm going to put you on the spot and ask that you stand, and if you can introduce yourself, and then the society steward is going to hand you something. Any visitors? Sanya. Welcome. Here we go. Hada. Simon. Welcome. The three of you. All right. We are very glad that you're joining us. With you visiting, I just do need to say that this is not our normal sanctuary, but it's in our old sanctuary. So this was our sanctuary 40 years ago. And we're currently busy with some renovations in the main sanctuary. And so that's why we've come back to go old school. And we're worshiping in the original sanctuary of the Lyttelton Methodist Church. But we're glad that you're joining us, and do pray that you would experience this as a spiritual home and experience God's blessing for you today. Our call to worship this morning comes from Psalm 108, and I'm going to be reading the first five verses. My heart is steadfast, O God. I will sing and make music with all my soul. Awake, harp and lyre, I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, O Lord, among the nations. I will sing to you among the peoples. For great is your love, higher than the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens, and let your glory be over all the earth. Thanks be to God for his word. Shall we pray together? Lord God, we thank you that Scripture tells us that your heart is steadfast. That you, O Lord, that you love us so much. That you care for us so much. And that as we gather today, we want to worship you, we want to praise you, we want to acknowledge just how awesome you are, Lord God. We thank you that Scripture tells us that you are with us, that you never leave us nor forsake us. And so we acknowledge your Holy Spirit in this moment and pray that your Holy Spirit may touch us as we worship together and as we spend this time together. Bless our time of worship. We ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so I'm going to invite you to stand together as we sing, "Come, now is the time to worship."
Just as you are to worship, come. Just as you are before your God, come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. The greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you. Come, oh, come.
worship the Lord.
Come.
You may be seated. Thank you. There are chairs right in front here. Hopefully you're not afraid of me, but you're welcome to come right to the front. I only bite on Mondays and Fridays. What's today? Friday. Come closer. Ceaseman. All right, a couple of notices that I need to share with you this morning. Just a reminder, if you do have your cell phones with you, please make sure they're on silent or off. Otherwise, when they... your nose, and then there is sanitizer at the back there. And then I also need to say, if you do need to go to the toilet during the service, you don't have to go around. You're welcome to come straight through this door for our visitors, straight through the door. On the right hand side, the ladies, off to the left is the gents. There's no hand towels, but there are paper towels and sanitizer, and you're most welcome to use that. The flowers this morning are in celebration or in loving memory of Martin, and that's from Auntie Pam Verster, 33 good years of marriage. Just a reminder, Wednesday mornings we have our liturgical communion worship service, and that's at 10 a.m. in the morning. Please, you're welcome to come and join us. And then if you have any prayer requests after the service, there is a time of prayer for those that would like to stay a little bit longer. Then our 9:30 worship service on a Sunday morning is live streamed. So this service is being live streamed onto YouTube. If you do miss a Sunday morning and you do need to catch up, you're welcome to go onto the YouTube channel. Just type in Lyttelton Methodist Church. You'll find us there. If it's not being live streamed, maybe one of our staff's not available, then what happens is we pre-record and it gets sent out Sunday morning as well. So you're welcome to watch online if you do miss. Then as things happen with our door stewards and greeters, we are looking for new greeters or door stewards for the 7:45 service. Just so has it that we're a little bit thin on volunteers for the 7:45 service. And so if you are able to assist at 7:45, somebody asked me this morning, what does that entail? That means that you need to be a little bit earlier, that you man the registration table, signing in people. It means that after the service, you count the money with a society steward, and generally, if there's any issues, that you run around and sort them out. Something like that. All right. Okay, so if you are interested, please let us know. Then also, we're going to go on to the next one, the slide, and I'm going to just drop the lights for a moment. You're welcome to move your chair next to your wife there. You are welcome. Every other couple's done that. Oh, they've already brought you a chair. How awesome is that? All right. If any of you recognize that, that's because those were the pews that were in our sanctuary that we've been using for 37 years. We've taken out the pews. They are now in the education center, and we are going to be selling off the pews. So some people have already spoken to me, Charlie, can we buy pews? Yes, you may. The 5-seater is going for 500 Rand. We've got 8 and 9 seaters. They're going for 1,000 Rand. But if you negotiate, I'll give you 999 Rand. Special offer. If you buy two of these, I'll make it 995. Okay? But then you've got to get in quickly. You've got to speak to me soon. All right. So we've got a whole bunch of these with the double wood on either side. I've actually got 3 pews at home, and they're out in the garden. Mine doesn't have cushions, however. But if you are interested in buying pews, or if you know of anybody that might want, or a wedding venue that might look for pews, please, we are selling them, and the proceeds that we will receive will go towards our renovation fund. All right, let me put back the lights on. All right, then the jumble sale ladies are saying thank you very much for your contributions. There is a request for homeware. Pots, pans, curtains, linen, shoes, especially men's shoes. And then the next jumble sale is happening on the 4th of November. And so if you'd like to donate, if you'd like to empty out your cupboards, if you haven't done your spring cleaning yet, please, by the 2nd of November, you can drop it off by the 2nd of November. Then the ladies or the team can still sort it out. Then the friends who care, they've made up the gift bags for the teens and the goggles, and this is packed and ready to go. And once again, thank you to all those that did help and helped with the packing and helped with the donating of that. Really appreciate that. On the 6th of November, we have our 7 a.m. prayer meeting, congregational prayer meeting. You're welcome to come and join us as we spend an hour together praying for our country, praying for our church, praying for Christians around the world, and any other issues that somebody might bring to our prayer meeting, we pray around that as well. On the 6th of November as well, Risoort Centurion is having a market day. That's Saturday from 8 a.m. to 12 noon. Curry and rice, pancakes, clothing stalls, needlework stalls, and much, much more. So if you have some spare money and you want to go and wander around, please go and support Risoort Centurion. Then on the 14th of November, it is our Remembrance Day service. Traditionally, we've had one service because we've been in the bigger sanctuary, but this year we are having to have two services, the 7:45 service and the 9:30. The 11 o'clock, the vernacular service, we've invited them to come to either of our services. And so the Remembrance Day service is happening on the 14th of November. If you have military medals that, if you were in the military or somebody in the family was in the military, you are most welcome to wear those medals on the 14th, as it is Remembrance Day celebration. Then the 22nd of November, Queenswood Home, they are having their mini Christmas market, 9 a.m. till 12 noon. Please come and support the Queenswood Home. If you would like to host a table, the tables are available at 120 Rand for the morning, and you can speak to Cheryl at the Queenswood Home. Then for our youngsters, the Scripture Union and the church have combined to run a youth camp for grades 4 through to grade 7s. Those in primary school will be housed on one side of the campsite. Those in high school will be housed on the other side. They'll share meals together, but they'll have their own separate programs. And that is the 17th to the 19th of December at Stony Ridge. So if you don't know what to do with your kids or your grandkids, palm them off to someone else to look after. I think it's an awesome idea. And then if they come back from then and they're still a handful, our church is running a holiday club 21st, 22nd, and 23rd of December. Yeah, at the church, and you are welcome to speak to Laura and Dimple about that. Right. Anybody celebrated or celebrating a birthday? Past week, coming week, any birthdays? No one getting older, we're all getting younger. Wow, 21st. Your son's name?
Kia.
Kia. Awesome, 21. There we go. Byron, 19 on the 19th. Awesome, congratulations. Well, we pray that the year ahead is full of God's blessing and God's presence for both of them. Any wedding anniversaries? No? Fine, be like that. All right, any good news to share? This is the way you're all supposed to put up your hands and say, good news is that we're here, good news is the sun is shining, good news is it is frak warm. I'm already getting hot. So there's no good news happening. Okay, Barbara? Rialda, what's your good news? Children got vaccinated, but there's a bit more. Keisha is a leader for next year. Keisha goes to grade 7 next year at Durancliffe Primary Law School and has been selected as a leader. Charlene? I was going to chirp you and say you sound surprised. Congratulations. There we go. That is a celebration. All right. Here we go. All right. Any other good news? Awesome. Okay. Shall we spend some time in prayer? Gracious Father God, we thank you for birthday celebrations. We thank you for Kia and for Byron, and we just ask your blessing upon them this coming year, that they may reach for the dreams, that they may reach their goals, that you may just allow them the boldness and the courage to step out and live life. And so, Lord, protect them and bless them. We thank you that Kisha has been elected as a leader for next year. We ask, Lord, that you may bless her, strengthen her, that as she takes that role, Father God, that she may just honor you through being a leader for Christ. We thank you that already some of our children are being vaccinated for the gift of that and for your protection. We thank you that Christopher has been accepted to high school, and pray too for the adjustments that he needs to make, just the orientation next year. Lord, may you bless him and may he experience more of you. Lord, we thank you for the good things that you are doing in our lives. And as we worship you, we know that you are God Almighty. Bless our time, we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to worship together as we sing One Thing Remains. Please be seated. Let us pray together. Lord God, we're a reminder that your love never fails, that your love continues on and on and on and on. And so, Lord, in our worship, we acknowledge your love. We acknowledge your greatness. We acknowledge that one thing remains constant, and that is your love for humanity. And so, Lord, as we come to hear your word, we ask that you'd open your word to us. We thank you, God, that you are a God that heals and restores, that you are a God that has heard our cry for mercy, that because of your great love for us, when we cry out, you respond, and you responded through your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to this earth, who came to this world, so that we might experience more of your love. And so, Lord God, today we say thank you. Thank you that when we confess our sins, you are faithful and just, and that you do forgive us. Thank you that when we acknowledge you as God Almighty, King of Kings, you forgive us. Thank you, Lord, that there is nothing that can separate us from your love. And so today we acknowledge that we are forgiven. Today we acknowledge that we are not alone, but that, Father God, you are with us, present with us, and that you have poured out your Holy Spirit with us to guide us and to lead us. Bless us, Lord. We ask and pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So what drives you? What drives you? And I'm not saying your spouse, so you would probably say they drive you up the wall, but I'm not speaking about that. What motivates you? What makes you get up in the morning and keep going? Money, okay? It's my wife, actually, because if I don't get up, she complains she wants coffee. No, I'm joking. It's her turn. Summer's her turn to get up early. Winter's my turn. I'm not even joking. Louise and I have this deal. During the cold months, I need to bring her coffee in bed. During the summer months, she gets up earlier, so she brings me coffee in bed. And I need to say, mornings when I wake up, I'm like, where is she? She needs to hurry up. And then I just send a WhatsApp, and then coffee comes. It's all really awesome. What motivates you? What drives you? What gets you up in the morning? What makes you live life? And I think Dion Jackson got it right. Do any of you know any of the songs by Dion Jackson? It's one of those that you should know if you think really hard, because the moment I say the title, you'll know the song. Love makes the world go round. Love. Love. Love that makes the world go round. I believe Dion Jackson knew what he was talking about. And the easiest I can say, or what makes sense for me, is when I say that, is I get up in winter when it's bitterly cold and make coffee for Louise while she's snug and warm in the bed. Not because I have to, not because she's going to be moody if I don't, but I do that because I love her. I want her to feel loved. And so I want to ask you another question. How do you feel when somebody loves you, cares for you, when somebody goes out of the way to sacrifice their own comfort to bless you with something? Does it make you feel good? And when you feel good, doesn't it kind of make you want to make them feel good? And so love makes the world go round. When we feel loved, it's easier to love. But when we feel discarded, when we feel outcast, when we feel thrown away, it's very difficult then to express love to others. And so it is, for me, love that makes the world go round. It's not the politicians. It's not the doctors. It's not the presidents and the kings and the queens. It is simple old love. Love makes the world go round. It is love that compels us in the mornings to get up. It is love that compels us to serve and care for others. Lyndall, I'm going to choose 1 John 4 as the first passage. 1 John 4, John is writing, and he writes about God's love and our love. And I'm going to read from verse 7 through to verse 11. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Thanks be to God for his word. The first thing that stands out there, John says, we ought to love one another. Now, doesn't that sound familiar? If you've ever read the Gospels, doesn't that sound familiar? Is that not in line with the teaching and preaching of Jesus Christ? In Luke 10 and Mark 12, Jesus is asked, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. But the second greatest command is this, love your neighbor. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's love that makes the world go round. It's love that compels us to love others. When we love, we are in God, because that's what it says. Because God is love. This passage reminds us that God is love. Because before we were even aware of God, before we were aware of God's love, God loved you and me. Now, in theological terms, that's called prevenient grace. Before we knew God loved us, God loved us. Before we were aware of God's presence, God was present. Before we were even aware that there was a God, God was working in our lives. We may not have seen it, we may not have sensed it, but God has always been working. That is prevenient grace. Our response to God's love, as described in 1 John 4, is to love. When we feel loved, to express that love to others, we ought to love, to love as God calls us to love. Now I want to look at 2 Corinthians 5. 2 Corinthians 5, and I'm going to read from verse 14. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old is gone, the new has come. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them. And he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal through us. We implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Thanks be to God for his word. We are there to reconcile others to God. We are there because Jesus Christ offered himself on the cross because God so loved us. And so we need to be compelled by this love that we have experienced to love others. Now, I want to share a bit of a personal story. Most of you that have been with me since I've been here know that I grew up in a military home. My dad's a military man, very strict discipline. And with that comes the, I want to call it the boundary of love. Military men aren't always lovable. And so my dad and my relationship was very strained. Because I'm a free-spirited person, I do what I want. And that means I pushed boundaries, which meant I got lots and lots of discipline opportunities. I'm trying to think carefully how to put this. I was in ministry here at this church as youth pastor many years ago, and one of my friend's grandmother passed away, and I went to support the family. I went and I was part of the funeral service, sat in the back, and I just listened. It was out in Chazina at the Catholic Church, and I can remember coming out of church and just thinking, I need to let my mom and dad know that I love them. And I thought, you know what I'll do? I'll just phone them and say, Mom, I love you. Then phone Dad and say, Dad, I love you. You know how difficult that was? My mom was easier because my mom's always been around and been the more affectionate one. And then I thought, okay, phone Dad. My dad wanted to talk about this and that, and I'm like, yeah. I'm like, you got this knot in my stomach. And then I'm like, I'm just going to say it. Dad, can you just listen for a moment? He's like, yeah. Dad, I love you. Dad, are you there? Dad. Okay, it's still connected. Dad? And all he said was, Charles, I'm proud of you. Snot entrana. I couldn't drive. I was crying because my dad had never in my life said to me, Charles, I'm proud of you. And in that moment, I decided I will always say to my mom and dad, I will stop and say, Mom, I love you. Dad, I love you. And can I tell you how it affected and changed our relationship? I love my dad to bits, and we're closer than we ever have been. Because to this day, on the phone, we will pause and say, Dad, I love you. And he'll say, Charles, I love you. And then we'll carry on talking, and then we say, okay, goodbye, cheers. Well, so often we say, love you, goodbye. But that love you, goodbye doesn't mean the same as, I love you. And I need to say, as much as I learned that then, I didn't realize it fully until I had my own children. Growing up in a military home, I thought that was the way that you dealt with children. You gave them discipline opportunities, sent them to the room, made them cry, and then you came out and you lived your life. And it was only when I went on an anger management course that I realized the damage that I was doing to my own son. I loved him, and I would say to him in the evenings, Gabriel, love you, good night. But I'd forgotten to say, Gabes, my boy, I love you. And I forgot to show the affection that I in myself had missed and yearned for. And so after this course and after going meeting with a psychologist, she said, all you need to do is give him a hug and say, my boy, I love you. And I started doing that. And I need to say, in the last 2 years, my son's now turning 12 in 2 months' time. In the last 2 years, I've seen a change in him because of how much a disciplinarian I was. There was this void, this gap between us. And then I consciously made the effort to say, my boy, I love you. I consciously make the effort to hug him. I grew up Afrikaans dad. You kiss dad goodnight. You kiss dad goodbye. You kiss dad. And Gabriel's like, you're a boy. You don't kiss me. I'm like, but Dad, Gabriel, I grew up. No. And so he doesn't allow me. So now I kiss him on the forehead. And he's like, But you know what's been happening in the last 2 years? He will walk past me while I'm cooking or doing something, and he'll come and give me a side hug and say, Dad, I love you. The last 6 months, he will come and he'll hug me and he'll kiss my shoulder. And then he says, Dad, I love you. And I wish I could explain, my knees go weak because I grew up and I never had that. I couldn't go and do that with my dad. I've hugged my dad now in the last 5 years more than I've ever hugged him. And it's helping my relationship with my son because I've realized I need to make the effort. And so often we forget that we are ambassadors for Christ, that we are the ones that are supposed to be sharing Christ's love with the world. But the world is so depraved, so broken, that love is twisted, distorted. And I want to say today, and the challenge for us today, is that we need to stand on what love is. And what is love? God is love. That's what John says. God is love. And when we love, we are in God. When we do not love, when we love twisted and warped, then we are not of God. And so the challenge for us is to love. We are compelled by God's love to love others. Early on, I asked you, how does it make you feel when you feel loved? That warm feeling, and you want to then bless the other person. You want to show them that appreciation. You want them to feel that love. Any of you feel and experience God's love before? Then we ought to be sharing that love with others. Our theme last year and this year, a running theme, has been about discipleship. And discipleship is about you and I growing as Christ followers. That's what discipleship is about, being more Christ-like. But it doesn't stop there. It continues to the fact that we are to be Christ-like. And Christ loved unconditionally. There was no strings attached. Before Christ knew you, Christ Jesus died on the cross for you. That's how much he loved you. He didn't know whether you were going to believe in him. He didn't know whether you were going to follow him, but he died in the hope that you would respond to his love. There are many people out there that don't know Christ's love. And do you know why? Because the love that they've experienced was twisted. Maybe covered in discipline. Maybe twisted in some other way or given in gifts. But love is unconditional. And Christ's calling upon our lives is to make disciples. And the way that we do that is to follow Christ's example, and that is to love. Now, as Christians, we know that the moment we say, I'm a Christian, we are labeled, we are judged. But imagine you put up your hand and you say, I am a Christian. Judge me, because all you're going to see is the love of Jesus Christ in my life. You'll see love in my words. You'll see love in my actions. You'll see love in my family. And that is what the world needs. It needs more love. And it starts simply by you and me saying to someone, honestly, genuinely, I love you. The greatest gift to me was me saying to my dad, to my mom, I love you. Because it changed my relationship with them. The greatest gift to me and my son's relationship is for me to realize that I need to do it with him as well. Not about the presence. It's not about the quality time. It's not about the love languages. It's about experiencing God's love. And we experience it differently. But when we are in Christ, we are called to share Christ's love. This is where it gets difficult. Because we live in an ego-driven culture. a society that is driven about with self-gratification, me, myself, and I. And yet, as Christians, we are there to share God's love. You know what God's love is? It's not what my need is. It's what's your need. So you want to stay in bed a little bit longer? Okay, I'll bring you coffee. Because then you feel loved. And guess what? When you feel loved, the next time you'll make me coffee. Love makes the world go round. Genuine love comes from God Almighty when we experience and when we acknowledge God's love. Christ calls us to stand apart. As he called the Corinthian church to stand apart, he did that because they lived in a mixed culture, a trade port where so many cultures came together, where there was so much dissension, so many idols, so much different worship. And Christ said the one thing that needs to set the church apart is God's love. And so he encouraged them, he challenged them to be different. And so I want to challenge us to be different. When we stand apart, Christ calls on us to love when no one else is loving. Christ calls on us to love before we are loved. Christ calls on us not just to see the needs around us, but to actively get involved to meet those needs. Christ calls upon us to hear the needs of people and then to respond to those needs. Christ calls upon us to love those in society that have been ignored. As Christ followers, we are compelled by God's love to reach out and to minister to the poor, to the hungry, to the wealthy, to the immigrants, to the children, to the senior citizens. There is no aspect of society that God does not want us to love and to embrace. As Christ followers, we can not stand by and allow the injustices not to be addressed. You are a Christ follower because God loved you. And if God loved you and you feel good about God loving you, then you need to live a life in such a way that it expresses God's love. God's love needs to compel us to love others. Christ loved us so much that he offered his life for us, for all of humanity. And so if there is no other reason to love, that's the one to hold on to. Christ so loved you that he died on the cross to atone for your sins so that you may experience God's love. The challenge today, this week, is take time and tell someone you love them. Not love you goodbye. Stop. Pause. Make sure they're listening. And say, I love you. It may be difficult because sometimes our family are difficult. It may be awkward because sometimes they will look at you and like, what? No, I'm just saying, I love you. I really, truly love you. Not because God loves me, because you are who you are and you're my family. I love you. We don't do it enough. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. I don't know if I'm going to be here tomorrow. I don't know if you're going to be here tomorrow. So don't wait. Say it today. They might be overseas. And that might mean a phone call. That's okay. Because they will hear in your voice that this is a serious moment for you. Shall we pray together? Gracious Lord, we thank you that you are a loving God. That it is your love that compelled Jesus Christ to die on that cross for us. That through his sacrifice that we are able to experience your love. That we are able to share in that love. And so, Lord God, may the world know that we are Christians by the love that we share with others. May the world know that we are Christian because we stand on your truths. May the world know we are Christian because they see Jesus in us. Bless us, we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we're going to sing together, "They Will Know We Are Christian by Our Love." Shall we stand together?
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that our unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love. Yes, yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. Each other we will walk hand in hand. We will walk with each other. We will walk hand in hand. Stand together and spread the news that God is in our land. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love.
Be seated. Thank you. Just a reminder that we do take up a retiring offering, and so the double doors where you came through, there are blue buckets for your tithes and offerings, and then there is a yellow bucket for the car guard donation. It's now an opportunity for us to share intercessory prayers, and so if you know of someone that needs prayers, you are welcome to share that person's name and the need, and then we will pray for them, and they'll go on our prayer chain as well. Are there any prayer needs? Sue? Kathy? Kathy, you'll be sued today. Sure, okay. Well, whatever she might have, Jada might have, because Jada's been off school for 3 days now as well. So Same thing. Okay. Okay. Awesome. Anybody else? Merlin's checkup. All right. Awesome. I see the hand at the back. I can't see who it is. Oh, it's Lally. And that's in Limpopo, right? Sorry? Yes. Amen. All right. So just to go through, we're going to be praying for Amity, for her infection, at the same time Jada and her pain and infection, then for Lynn Stent, just for her breathing, but also for the family that surround her, for guidance and wisdom as to how to support her best. Then we'll be praying for Nolan as he continues and goes for his checkup. We're going to be praying for the four children that have been kidnapped, that they will be found, and we're just praying for strength for the family. And then we continue to pray for the eradication of COVID, and that God would bring healing and restoration. We're also going to be praying for our elections, which is, I think, 8 days away now. Next week, Monday. So we need to be praying for that. Shall we pray together? Gracious Lord, we come before you, and you are the God that heals, you are the God restores. And so we pray for Amity and for Jada with their infection, whatever it may be. Father God, we pray that you would pour out your healing balm upon them, that you would remove the pain, that you would remove the infection, that they would experience your healing touch and know that God Almighty, the King of Kings, has healed them. We continue to pray for Lynn and for her breathing and for her general health. And we just ask, Lord God, that she may experience your touch. We pray for those, particularly the family that surround her, for wisdom, for guidance, that they may know how best to treat her, how best to support her. And we just thank you that she is not alone during this time. Lord God, we've been journeying with Nolan for quite some time, and we just pray and continue to pray for total healing and restoration, that as he goes again for a checkup, Lord, that they would be able to give you the honor and the glory for the miracle that has happened in that young man's life. And so we pray, Lord, for good results. Lord God, we just think of this tragic news of four children that have been kidnapped. We just think of the family, what hell they must be going through. We pray for the safety of those boys. We pray for whoever it may have been who's orchestrated this, that they would release those children unharmed, and that they would be reunited with their family, Father God. Lord God, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and you are the God that heals and restores. And so we pray for the eradication of COVID upon this world, upon this earth, upon your people, humanity. We pray, Father God, that you would remove COVID from this planet, Lord God, that we would be able to give you the honor and the glory. Lord God, as we come closer to the time of elections, we do pray that you would raise up Christian leaders who would offer love, offer a standard, a value, a Christian ethos in our government, in our councils, in our municipalities, that they would stand up and be counted as ambassadors of Christ. And so, Father God, we pray for peaceful elections. We pray for peace upon our land. We ask, Lord, that those that are being elected would eradicate violence, eradicate crime, eradicate the evil that has plagued our land for far too long. Lord, we pray that the elections will be peaceful and that people will go and vote. Lord, we offer these prayers to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and all God's people said, Amen. Shall we stand together as we say the benediction? You're welcome to raise your hands if you want. We say together, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen. The peace of the Lord go with you. Amen. Just before you go, there are still of those food packs, the food packets that are in the hall, in the kitchen. And if you want to take a box, you're welcome to take a box and distribute to those that are in need, particularly the guys at the traffic lights or stop streets. You're welcome to give them a pack of food that they're then able to cook and provide for their families. Thank you. Bye-bye.